Hello, PC Graphics fans here, I guess.
Yeah!
Awesome.
I'm from DICE, which is a studio in Stockholm, Sweden. Here's a couple of shots of our studio. It's a pretty nice studio we have. That's me. I'm right here sitting for a game. I like to collect monitors when I'm not.
Monitors. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I guess most of you guys have played these games before that we're here. How many here have played all of these games?
We're all music!
Yeah, that's awesome, also. So I'm going to talk about BF3. As all of you guys know, it's a 64-player multiplayer game, our big return to the actual true Battlefield experience. We also have single-player and co-op, but for the PC audience, that's usually not that nice. But they're pretty fun. One thing that's really new and cool about BF3 is that we have this giant, large landscape environments, as well as both urban and indoor environments that I hope you guys will like and see. And we've developed this game for quite many years now, and PC has always been our lead platform, the way we really wanted to design and develop the game for. And in order to do that also, we've added the requirement of having DX10 and DX11 available, because we're able to write more directly to the GPU, and it's a lot more efficient for us to work in that sense, to really take advantage of all the new features in the GPUs. And in order to create BF3, we created a new engine, or a new major revision of the engine, the Frostbite engine that we've been working on for quite some time, called Frostbite 2, where we've done some massive enhancements and improvements with regard to both animation, rendering, lighting, destruction, as well as our landscapes and general streaming systems. So it's been a pretty major revision that we've been working on for a long time here, with PC as a focus from the start. But I'm here to talk today to talk about graphics, so let's just jump straight into it. Here we have a pretty fancy screenshot from BF3. This specific part is the single player, so this is one reason to play single player. The graphics there in certain type of environments are really, really awesome. It looks cool in multiplayer also, but it's a little bit different experience than single player, the way you play the game. One important thing that when you're talking about graphics though is that most people look at the screenshot and say that that was good graphics. Which I hope you guys agree with this feature. Yeah! But it's important to really consider that graphics is really the core portion of the techniques of how you show things on the screen. It's not really what makes a screenshot pretty, or what makes a screenshot visually pleasing. Graphics is the core component there. What we're seeing here really is the sort of aesthetic of the picture, that we're trying to build a full picture where everything fits together. So it's not just about the shiny shader or a good lighting effect or a good terrain rendering method. It's when all these things come together, it forms a sort of a whole and create a pleasing aesthetic of the game. And it was actually a really cool talk, a really cool presentation that happened a few weeks ago on Penny Arcade about the difference between graphics and aesthetics. Aesthetics is the A here, and graphics is really a way to, it needs to be a method of serving aesthetics, and also gameplay in as well. And I think many games are sort of missing this key correlation between aesthetics and graphics, that graphics is really there to improve the aesthetics and the visual style you have for the game, to create a pleasing whole of it. It's not the end goal in itself. And also with gameplay, we see that more and more now, but as we add more graphics, we add it in a way where it actually improves gameplay, because you see more, you get better visibility in your levels, you see muscle flashes in dark areas, you actually see those snipers hiding out or anything like that. So this is just a core thing I wanted to clear up starting out. But let's jump into the graphics and some of the visual major components that we have in our engine and our game. So I sort of divided up into five major areas that I'm going to talk a little bit about, and then finish off with some more stuff. So the first thing is how we handle objects in general in our scene. Objects is a huge portion of everything that we see. Then we also have the lighting engine that we've done massive improvements to create the different types of environments. And then the way we do effects, which has always been a big thing for Battlefield. Landscapes and terrain is also another big portion there, and also post-processing that we've been working on. So I will go through these individual components. and talk about this, a lot of details in Qunit. So let's start out with the objects. There's really kind of a lot of different types of objects we have in our engines in our game. Every single soldier you see, every single vehicle, every tank, every helicopter, those are very important gameplay objects. Those are really what the game is. You are a soldier, you're controlling a soldier that's shooting on another soldier or a vehicle or a tank or something like that. So those are our key gameplay objects that are really, really important for the rendering and for the game in general. We also have tons of environment objects like trees and bushes in order to create a suitable landscape. As well as man-made objects and certain blocks like buildings, fences, containers, nothing. And then effects is another option also. So, but in order to be able to handle huge amounts of objects on the level, you can have up to 10,000 different types of objects on the level. And so it requires a lot of effort in the engine and in the gameplay as well. But in order to render that efficiently and handle that and make it fit into memory, even on a very high-end GPU, you still have a limited amount of memory. So we have some really interesting systems on how to manage and stream meshes and textures. We do LED and distance calling in a lot more expanded way than we've done before. We also have a occlusion calling system, which makes rendering fast but not rendering things that you can see, which kind of like make a lot of sense. And one thing that's always been strong with Frostbite and we've been going further on is to be able to do parallel rendering, to utilize all the multi-core PCs out there, quad-core or even more CPUs on CPU cores, to render all the entire model we have in parallel and also simulate all the vehicle physics as well as the trees swaying in the wind and all those type of things. So I'm going to talk a little bit more details about a couple of these very important points for the way our engines work. So with the mesh and texture stream, that's something we haven't really had before in Frostbite or really in any valve game. Basically, you just fill up memory in the engine and then, let that run. I've had some graphics options in order to scale it a little bit. But back here when we did BFT, we saw that there's some issues with doing that approach, that there's so many different PC configurations, so it's kind of difficult to just fill up memory and then hope that works, because there's so many different configurations of memory and what type of settings that we have. So streaming assets has a lot more flexibility there, because we can overall just reduce the memory amount that we require to be consistent that when running, we have smaller sets loaded, so we're running more different configurations. But we can also do it the opposite way, we can increase quality by using that memory in a better way and add a lot more variety and levels by having tons of unique meshes and unique textures everywhere. This really creates a freedom for level artists and level designers when they create lots. Don't really have to think that much about, this is good in memory, we just have to add a lot of content to the levels, and then we stream that automatically. And this is something we do both in Singapore and in Singapore, and on all platforms. So the way we do this, the core streaming is, it's based on not the exact custom that you're having, the exact UI direction, because that simply doesn't really work that well on PC when you're running with a keyboard mouse, you're going to be completely with a mouse, you can't really stream stuff fast enough for that to work. So we do all this based on the camera position, where you are on the level, and the distance between individual objects and textures, and prioritize that and look in the background. And there's a lot of games that have been doing this for quite some time, and we've done it reasonably successfully in many games also, but one problem that's been that we've had for a long time in the games that's been penalizing is that most of these games that have been using streaming has been doing it in DX9, and you can't really do it in DirectX9 very correctly, because there will be a CPU spikes with streaming new content, because the APIs are not really designed for that approach. So we've been working pretty closely with Microsoft and even all the IHVs such as NVIDIA to come up with a solution in DX11 where there's a solution built into DX11 where you can have a separate thread that creates all the textures, creates all the meshes and drivers are specifically optimized for this case that make sure these giant textures that we're loading are uploaded in parallel so you don't see any CPU stalls based on that. That's really important in order to utilize the game quite a lot. So a couple of examples on what we stream. On a multiplayer level, we typically have around 200 and 250 megabytes of meshes. It might not sound that much, but if you consider that most people have a graphics card of only a gigabyte, that's again a quarter of the memory just for meshes, which is just a pretty small portion of the rest of the things that you have. That is actually becomes quite interesting to see a portion of that memory. textures. There's, we have a lot more. We have up to 1.5 gigabytes of textures on any single multiplayer level. And while there are parts that have 1.5 gigs of memory, that's not really the norm. People with a lower end card, or even people with a higher end card and running a higher resolution, they can't fit all of that. So that's the major reason why the screens are. So these settings are primarily set through the texture quality and the mesh quality settings in the options, where we set a different type of pool size, how much pictures and meshes you have to load in the memory at a single point. So for high, you use 300 megs, and for ultra, you use 500 megs. So ultra is most of the time for ultra calculated as part of the box for bandwidth. This is working out really quite nicely for us. I haven't really heard anyone having problems with it either, so that's a good sign. Another aspect, which we're talking about optics, is these quite complex levels. This is one of the levels you can see here, done on the peak. And if you look at this, these are a lot of objects being rendered here at a higher distance, you sort of find here. But if you look at it, a lot of these objects are really the same type of object, because these are like model systems or something that are just, we're just rendering them multiple times. The garbage just plays the same object. And it's not a lot of smaller objects that are the same, they just repeat them. And typically, rendering these types of things can be really quite heavy because there's so many objects. And this is another really good DX11 optimization we've done for specifically for Frostbite 2. There's like quite a lot of effort of trying to do this, is that we use a method called instancing. So we take all of these, I'm not sure, 10 objects and render them with a single dropper. So we send a single command to the GPU to render all of these at the same time, which massively reduces the CPU burden to render this. And we can do this type of instancing on all of the different types of meshes that we have on skinny trees or on these type of meshes, or even on the structural buildings that actually look really quite different. This massively reduces the draw cost. So this level, in this exact view, has 4,000 draw costs. We're running an ultra copy. There's an ultra being further reduced the LED distances and the calling distances. So we'll see even more of the distance. So this dropped it to less than a quarter of the number of draw costs there, which massively reduces the CPU cost of the rendering. And makes it faster both on the low end parts, because there you suddenly have a new core or something like that rendering takes quite a lot of CPU off. But also, if you have a really good machine, then you run the higher topics and also can benefit from reducing the amount of cost. So, that was a little bit about topics. Another major area that comes to improvements on, and I hope you really can feel it about this way, is the lighting and the way we do lighting. So, this is pretty interesting screenshot in an indoor environment. This is something we've never had in any healthy game before. And we're pretty proud of all the stuff we've done here. So, just going through a little bit and capturize what we're having to see. So, here's just a point light from the sky. The fire is just lighting up the environment. This looks pretty cool. So, it's like when there's burning water in it. Here's just a standard spotlight of carving lit by a chocolate in the parking garage. And here you see the specular harness between from the bars and from the bumpers in the scene. And here we also have some classic lasers just doing the thing. And also some emissive particles that are sort of being lit up, lighting up the environment quite a bit too, thanks to the view. So this gives a quite interesting overall picture, a lot of detail and a lot of dynamic. And all these light sources are dynamic in the scene, so stuff can move around, stuff can explode, we're shooting and also flashes. So we spent a lot of effort on improving lightings, and I'll go into more different types of stuff that we're having. We also have a shot of the lighting, but this is a much of a different screenshot. This is a screenshot in an outdoor environment, on the same level you saw earlier with all the drawbells on. But here we only have a single big invisible light source here, which is the sun. And this is actually quite difficult to light these things properly, because the sun is so bright and there's areas that are so very dark in the scene. So what we need here is to have a really proper HDR rendering of the scene that captures all the different intensities of the light sources that we have, even though it is just a single sunlight in the sky. So we render everything in FP16, which is an HDR format on GPUs, and then we can take a look at that picture and estimate what the exposure should be for it to get a good view of it, make sure that the darks are not too dark and the brights are not too bright, and then adapt to different environments. And the deep part of the HDR rendering was also blue. Because blue, back in the day, was just a filter that someone added on top of the screen to make it I don't know, everything in the core crap actually. But nowadays, and the way we use blue here is that blue is a natural part of nature already right now. Because blue is what happens when you have something that's brighter than one. Then you need to show that somehow. And the way the human eye works and the way a camera works is that if something is brighter than the max brightness you can have, then it bleeds over to the rest of us. So blue is really an essential part of it. So you see a little bit here on this screen shot, but I have some other examples here also. Here's a screenshot without no blue. Looks pretty okay, but you see this kind of harsh edge here that makes the picture look kind of weird and unnatural. And then if you add some blue on that, without really destroying the game here, and it's just improves the picture overall. It makes it a smoother, better picture that fits in better in the environment. Oh, someone's back. Okay, so let's go into some more techniques now, actually, the lighting and things like that. This is a little bit more complex, but the way our entire rendering pattern works is that we use a scheme called deferred shading, which is quite different from the more traditional rendering methods that most games use. There are a few other games that use deferred shading also, like Killzone on consoles, for example, and a few that use a little bit hybrid schemes, but most games still use forward rendering. That's what we've been using before with Frostbite and our previous games as well. But the difference with deferred shading is that instead of rendering all the objects just directly and then have the final picture directly that they then just use a post-processing on, instead with deferred shading, what we do is that we render all the objects, but we render them not with the final lighting, we render them to what's called a G-buffer, which I'll show just in a second here. And then we take that buffer and light it. So you can separate the object rendering from the lighting, which is a major benefit in our case as well, a lot of different types of lighting environments. So it enables us to have components of really large or really large dynamic light sources in our lives. And we also have destructible light sources and ambient light sources. And also the lighting we see is just more dependent on the number of pixels that light requires instead of any object pixels. So we have a highly adjustable lighting scheme. And the point of is that any question about learning, a lot of GPU memory and a lot of memory management. So running the game with works and say it can take up to 160 megs of this piece of offer can be 160 megs of memory, which is kind of prohibitive, especially the memory RAM with trying to render that at 60 FPS, can be quite heavy. But we'll talk a little bit more about performance later. So here's how that G buffer looks like when we're using it for shading. So when we're rendering the objects, this is really what we're rendering out. We're not rendering out the final picture, we're rendering out a bunch of multiple types of textures that contain different components. They contain the diffuse color of the surface, which is like the standard color. It contains a specular scaling factor for that, as well as a smoothness value, which is sort of how strong the specularity is on the surface. We also render out normals that we use for the lighting later on. And this is really quite a different scheme to render. I don't know that many PC games that do it fully as we do, but we find it to be a really interesting method that helps us quite tremendously to achieve very different type of lighting environments. And going to even more lower detail tech on how we use this, that when just doing some experimentations with the deferred shading, we found that with the NVIDIA 11 GPUs, found pretty early that we could use compute shaders there. Which is a way of not using the graphics rendering pattern on the GPU, but just using it as a general super parallel processor pretty much. I found a method that we call using tile-based lighting, where we can use a compute shader, which is pretty much just a programming one that runs on the GPU and goes through every pixel, and it can do a lot of better light fighting to remove the many light sources subject to each pixel, and as such, more efficiently light that. We save a lot of memory bandwidth here, because I just want to mention we're sort of in the problem with deferred shading, and we have this pretty fast G-buffer of 160 megs with full quality, and you have to read in that every single pixel when you light it or stuff otherwise, but with this computer-based approach, we improve performance quite significantly, especially when using, say, these really large buffers. So this is something that's only available in Frostbite when using DX11. So it's a pretty cool benefit that we've been working on. If you use DX10, it still runs, and we're using more traditional methods, it's just a bit slower, especially when using it. But it still runs and looks the same.